A long-range missile, fired directly at your capital, is generally considered an act of war, even under the strictest of definitions. So early in November, when a missile was fired from Yemen toward Saudi Arabia's Riyadh airport, there was little question on the matter. The Saudis have spent the past 2 years in an open war with the Houthi rebels responsible for the launch. The bulk of the kingdom's ire, however, wasn't directed at the Houthis. It was directed at Iran, which the Saudis accused of supplying the missiles. Iran denied it. "We see this as an act of war," the Saudi Foreign Minister Adel Al-Jubeir told CNN. "Iran cannot lob missiles at Saudi cities and towns and expect us not to take steps." In something of a diplomatic bank shot, the Saudis also accused Lebanon, and its Iran-backed Hezbollah factions, of the same thing the Gulf Affairs Minister Thamer Al-Sabhan told Al Arabiya television that his government considered aggressive acts by Hezbollah to be acts of a declaration of war against Saudi Arabia by Lebanon and by the Lebanese Party of the Devil. The U.S., too, has found itself on both sides of such rhetorical acts of war. "We've stood accused," in September, the North Korean Foreign Minister Ri Yong-ho told reporters in New York that since the United States declared war on our country, we will have every right to take countermeasures, including the right to shoot down United States bombers. The declaration of war he was referring to was a tweet in which President Trump suggested that if the minister echoes thoughts of Little Rocket Man, they won't be around much longer. "We've also lobbed our own charges." Senior lawmakers, including Senators John McCain and Ben Cardin, have labeled Russia's interference in the 2016 election an act of war. As of October, the U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, Nikki Haley, agreed, declaring that when a country can come interfere in another country's elections, that is warfare. An act of war, or casus belli, is supposed to be an action that justifies a military response, something along the lines, historically, of sinking a battleship or assassinating an archduke. But the striking thing about all these acts of war over the past year or so is that none have led to war between the nations involved, and few people seriously thought that they would. Yes, tensions are growing between Saudi Arabia and Iran, but they remain well short of military confrontation. North Korea and the United States are technically already at war. The Korean War ended in a 1953 armistice. Not a peace treaty, but neither side has unleashed any of its leaders' threatened fire, Kim, or fire and fury, Trump. The offending acts may be dangerous or egregious, but none are quite as profound a break from the status quo as all those statements claim. So what, exactly, is the goal of labeling them so dramatically? The 19th-century Prussian general and strategist Karl von Clausewitz famously argued in On War that war is a continuation of policy by other means. The quote is generally and correctly taken as an argument that war is a natural extension of political conflict, but the "by other means" part is just as critical. War, von Clausewitz wrote, is defined by the peculiar nature of the means which it uses. Acts like killing, the destruction of property and the taking of prisoners, most of which would be considered criminal in peacetime. It had already been said that the special circumstances of war made such peculiar acts justifiable, or even noble. Hugo Grotius, the 17th century Dutch scholar considered a founder of international law, argued in The Rights of War and Peace that wars can be legally justifiable and that for the attainment of their objects, they must employ force and terror as their most proper agents. An act of war, then, is a moment of transition from one sort of politics, with one set of rules, to another. At times, these transitions have been bizarrely formal. In 1609, Spain and the Dutch Republic agreed to stop fighting for 12 years, then seamlessly resumed hostilities when the truce was over. Franklin Roosevelt's 1941 date, which will live in infamy, speech illustrates just such a transitional moment. In its second line, it notes that as of the day before the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, a quintessential act of war, the United States was at peace with that nation. Following the attack, however, hostilities exist, and so the president asked Congress to declare that since the moment the first bomb dropped, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire. If that language sounds a bit stilted today, it may be because countries rarely officially go to war with one another anymore. Yes, the world may be full of armed conflicts, from Afghanistan to Myanmar to South Sudan, it may be full of terrorism and political violence. But the traditional form of conflict that defined much of the last few centuries, in which one national government declares war on another, and armies are dispatched into opposing territory, just about never happens. Opposing nations are far more likely to use economic sanctions, or wage cyber war, or sponsor rival militias in conflicts like Yemen and Syria. This is still policy by other means, it's just that the means carefully skirt anything von Clausewitz might have recognized as a war. There are plenty of explanations for this. Economic globalization, the high costs involved with modern weaponry, perhaps the centuries-long civilizing process described in the Harvard psychologist Steven Pinker's 2011 book The Better Angels of Our Nature. But in their own recent book, The Internationalists, the Yale legal scholars Una A. Hathaway and Scott J. Shapiro make a surprising argument. Governments don't declare war on one another anymore because doing so is illegal. Their argument traces back to the Kellogg-Briand Pact, a 1928 agreement in which most of the world's nations pledged to renounce war as an instrument of national policy. The pact is often ridiculed by historians and international relations scholars, mostly because it was quickly followed by what turned out to be the single bloodiest war in human history. But Hathaway and Shapiro trace the agreement's DNA through the Nuremberg trials to the establishment of the United Nations, and to today's long-lasting state of official peace. Even those skeptical about this argument will have to acknowledge the author's point that something has changed. Today, they write, war is regarded as a departure from civilized politics, whereas once it was civilized politics. The obvious complication, of course, is that the world's major powers are, in another sense, always at war. Vladimir Putin's Russia has famously employed hybrid war tactics to destabilize wayward neighbors like Ukraine. China touts its own peaceful development while deploying military assets into the South China Sea. And the killing, in October, of four U.S. Green Berets in Niger, a country where most Americans, and many lawmakers, most likely had no idea U.S. troops were stationed, is prompting another round of debate over the legality and objectives of an American war on terror that has now lasted more than 16 years. The U.S. hasn't declared an actual war since World War II, but we remain embroiled in some of the world's deadliest conflicts, many under an authorization for use of military force passed immediately after 9/11's act of war, despite the fact that many of the groups currently being targeted didn't exist at the time. Our war in Iraq and war in Afghanistan seem less like distinct conflicts than facets in the larger pattern of how we interact with dozens of nations around the world. When you call something an adversary does an act of war, it is generally intended as a justification for the actions you plan to take. It's a signal governments send to rally their people around the flag, bring allies to their aid and warn enemies away from aggressive actions. The gloves are coming off, and extraordinarily violent actions are permitted in order to make things right. But when war never comes, when there's no Rubicon to cross, and the line between war and non-war is illegible, the power of that signal is steadily diminished. It becomes nothing more than countries calling foul on one another in a game whose rules haven't been fully defined. Right now, the cost of throwing around terms like act of war and declaration of war seems remarkably low. If describing something as war doesn't actually require fighting a war, backing up your description with military force, and committing to either victory or surrender, then why not talk tough, ramping up the hyperbole and threatening a crisis? That's assuming, of course, that it's all hyperbole and can be trusted to stay that way. A pessimistic person might just as easily take all these claims of warfare as a different kind of warning, a sign that the decline of war was announced prematurely, and that the world is at risk of slipping back, at any moment, toward the peculiar means of old. One of these days, it's easy to imagine, an act of war might provoke something astonishing, an actual war.